Hi. As you might have noticed, I'm just a voice. I'm not actually there in person. A series of really unfortunate and really badly timed events meant I kind of had to miss my flight to Melbourne. I was really looking forward to meeting everyone, and I am absolutely devastated that I can't be there with you. But thank you for still coming, and a big massive thanks to Chad for letting me record the talk instead. Before I begin, I'd like to preface with a trigger warning. I'm going to talk about male aggression and post-traumatic stress disorder. If you don't feel you are up for it or feel uncomfortable at any point during this talk, you're welcome to just leave. I completely understand. I won't be offended. I mean, I won't even know. I'm literally on the other side of the world. So with that, let's begin. Hi, again. My name is Rosa. I am a freelance game designer and producer. On April 10th, 2018, someone stepped into my room and shouted at me so violently and so aggressively, I had to call the police. It was the explosive end of an abusive partnership, which had been escalating for months. I had kept trying to just survive, but on that day, I was so terrified. I decided all I could do was cut all my ties. One day, I'll have the strength to talk about what happened in the lead up, but today really isn't that day, and who knows if I'll ever feel comfortable to talk about it. Instead, today I'd like to talk about a game. In early November 2018, Jupiter Heedley asked me if I wanted to make a game for the Meditations Project. You might have heard about it. It was led by Rami Ismail, and there was a big fuss about it when it was released at the start of 2019. Another 360 developers would be taking part in the Meditations Project, one for each day of the calendar. The plan was to pick a date in 2018, reflect on what happened that day, and make a game about it. The other artists would do the same, and they'd all get bundled up and released in 2019 on their respective dates. I knew instantly I had to make mine about April 10th, 2018. At the time, I had just finished a book by Doris C. Rush, who is, by the way, a very talented game designer and academic. Her book is called Deep Games, Designing Games with Meaning and Purpose. Deep games are games about the human condition. In other words, they are games about the intricate web of thoughts and feelings we find ourselves entangled in and are trying to navigate and make sense of. Deep games try to express aspects of the human experience. They take our inner worlds and make them tangible for others to hold and understand. Humans have tried to express themselves via art since, well, we learned how to splash paint on cave walls. We went from representing people and animals and moved to trying to capture abstract emotions too. Commentary on the Apocalypse is a book which was written in the 10th century by a Spanish monk. He modernized the apocalypse and tied it to human experiences of the time. The book talked about greed and corruption in the church, a mother's love protecting us from evil, and finding hope when we're desperate. The book became a bestseller, if the concept of bestsellers could have existed at the time. Artists started illustrating these abstract but very human experiences written in the book. To signify a mother's love, they drew a woman holding a shield facing a many-headed dragon. She stands on the moon and holds the sun as her shield, which represents the universe supporting her. The dragon represents the evils of humanity, and her hand reaches out to it as if trying to tame it. Much later, the Romantics began painting small figures against vast, majestic landscapes to try and convey that feeling of awe and terror at the wonders of the world. The Expressionists literally tried to convey their feelings on their canvases, hoping that we would feel them too. I think games are no exception to this tradition. Reading Rush's book was a relief for me. For years, I had been frustrated by the mainstream's reluctance to make games about deeper topics. I watched Lady Bird and Roma and thought, where are the games about the search for peace and balance in tumultuous times? The games about finding your family or growing closer to your mother? I wanted deep games. I wanted to see games about breakups and abortions, about losing a grandparent, a cat, moving countries, growing up, moving out of your parents' house, learning to live on your own, with your boyfriend, with a friend. Games about the awkwardness of having sex with a lover for the first time, or the comfort of an old one. Having to ask for help, how to atone for our mistakes, learning to forgive others, games about getting lost, finding friends, growing old, and making peace. In other words, the vast, rich, human experiences we all seem to be living every day, but never expressing in our games. I think it's critical that games like this exist. These games could help us understand each other a little better. They could evoke feelings in us we didn't even know we could feel, and make us better people. Rush came in and said, yes, we can make games about the human condition, and this is how I do it. She laid out her design process into clear steps. First, she would take a theme, break it down into its component parts, and then build it back up via metaphorical mechanics. The design process has a lot of similarities to the one I had learned while I was in architecture school. Take a theme, analyze it, and build it back up using your construction materials. Every corner, every wall, every pathway, every door, and every window must be a reflection on your theme. Never lose sight of your theme. My architecture professors drilled that lesson in very hard. I came out of architecture school understanding that every great piece of art has a theme, which the artist ties back to with every tool their medium can afford. Let me set a few examples. Goya's Saturn devouring his son makes me think about the lengths to which men will go to maintain their positions of power. Saturn's body is mangled and shaped like a monster. Colors are dark and sinister. His eyes look at the distance in terror, mortified of a future where he is no longer almighty. Every stroke points at the inhumanity of patriarchs, maintaining their authority via any means necessary. Dorothea Tanning, who is a wonderful surrealist artist, made a painting called Musical Chairs, which to me speaks about getting your first period. A girl is falling off of a chair, her back arched in pain. It reminds me of playing children's games and suddenly having to face the pains of being an adult when you're way too young to understand what is going on. Puberty picks us off one by one, like a game of musical chairs. Now we are afraid to sit down, just in case we leave that dreaded red stain on the seat. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, I think, explores the theme of male role models. Faced with new powers, Miles searches for a father figure that will teach him how to be Spider-Man. The film takes us through depictions of masculinity, the father who Miles at first rejects as someone he wants to become, Peter B. Parker, who is overwhelmed at the responsibility of being a positive male role model, and Fisk, whose family will always leave him because he has to face and fix his own toxic masculinity. Great games too need a central theme, which the designer reflects back on with every aspect of the game. The mechanics, the art, the user interface, the story, the characters, the system, everything. Take Life is Strange. Everything in that game ties back to the theme of enjoying the moment. Most of the game is set during the golden hour, which is only a fleeting moment in the day, where the sun is at just the right position in the sky, that it casts everything in a beautiful golden light. Max, the main character, is into photography, which is about capturing the moment. The game allows you to sit in any scene and observe what's around you, enjoying that snapshot in time. And of course, the plot is about regaining those precious, beautiful moments that you lost with an old best friend. Now, I'm not saying that every piece of art has one true interpretation. I'm not saying that at all. But rather, think of it like every piece of art has a key. That key is the theme. And the key might be a little bit different from person to person, but the point is, when you use that key to interpret the piece of art, everything clicks into place, and the whole artwork begins to make so much more sense. It's that moment when message and craft align in an art piece that it can create an incredibly powerful experience. So, my game, April 10th. I confess, I avoided making this game. I knew it would be so difficult to look back at what happened that day. I'd have to discern a theme through a cloud of trauma and then break it down into its component parts. It just sounded like a terrible time. Simply the mention of the man's name who shouted at me sent me into an episode of PTSD. I'd shake, sweat, and throw any productivity out the window for the day. And now I was making myself not just relive the whole thing, but also analyze it? Who does that to themselves? I had already gone through enough. This whole episode had already cost me enough time and energy and money, and maybe I should just change my date on the meditations project to my birthday. My birthday was a fun day, no trauma there, right? So I did. I changed the date of my meditations game to my birthday. There's a thing called artist dates. They are like dates, but you're going out with yourself. You circle a day that you are going to dedicate just to you, and you go for a walk, explore a museum, go to a concert, see an exhibition, or really whatever tickles your fancy. The most important aspect of an artist date is that you listen to yourself and let your environment inspire you. Artist dates are one of the tools in the artist toolbox with which to find inspiration. Through them, you can find themes about the human experience from which to make a game about. It's especially useful when you have to find a new theme for your meditations game and have no idea where to even start. There are other methods to finding themes. Journaling is another big one. Keep a notebook and write down a stream of consciousness every day. Come back to it weeks later, and you'll be able to see patterns in your life from which to make a painting, or a short story, or a sculpture, or even a game. You can also simply have meaningful conversations with others. Skip the small talk and ask people what has given them pause for thought this week, what recent thing they did and feel proud about. Ask them what would a life well lived be like for them. In other words, no one cares about the weather. Everyone can see it was drizzling this morning and now it's sunny. Just ask instead what they like to do when it starts raining or on a really sunny day. When was the last time they got caught in a thunderstorm? Were they ever afraid of thunder? If they had a arranged date and it started pouring, are they the type of person who would cancel a date or go? I went to galleries to see where different paintings would take me and talk to friends about what was meaningful to them. I was trying to find a new theme for my meditations game, But every time, I kept circling back to April 10th. It was following me everywhere. Every day. I couldn't keep denying that that day had marked me. It had turned my life upside down, for better or for worse. And his voice, piercing, chilling, savage voice, was still ricocheting inside of me. I had to get it out. And if making this game was one way of finding closure, then I owed it to myself to do it. So, I changed the date back to April 10th, and I finally sat down to make it. Right, so, let's break down what happened on that hateful day. First, I tried to identify what that day was to me. It was a moment I felt I was in danger. I was threatened and felt incredibly alone and vulnerable. It was a moment of violence, perpetrated by an angry and at the time monstrous looking man. Sadly, so many of us know about male aggression. We've all met him or know of him, the entitled man who thinks the world owes him that victory screen, that others are just NPCs without needs, only here to shower him with applause and a few health potions. He's entitled to praise and power because that's what he's been taught he deserves. He is born to be special, to be powerful, to be great. Therefore, violence is allowed against anyone because he is the hero. He has every right to corner you and shout at you, to invade your boundaries, your space, trap you and belittle you, because in his mind, all his actions are justified. Because he is the hero. I'm so tired of that trope. I didn't want to make another game about men. We already have so many. So I started thinking about what else April 10th was to me. April 10th was a turning point. Before that day, I thought myself to be Wonder Woman. I had to be strong and incredibly capable for others. When people would ask me how I was, I would always lock my own problems away, smile, and say I was fine. I mean, I had to. I joined the games industry right as Gamergate happened. To survive, I decided the best thing I could do was to always be positive. I could be someone that offered hope to people. That other women hopefully felt they could rely on me. I'd be self-sufficient and strong, independent. I wouldn't need anyone else. But on April 10th, I had to rely on others. And I'm terrified of thinking what would have happened had I been on my own. My friend was in the room. When he saw things getting violent, and that I was calling the police, he stepped in between me and the aggressor and ushered him out. I later sat as he paced. Both our hearts were pumping in shock. I was trembling. He suggested we do yoga, so we stood side by side and stretched together. My other friend hugged me and cuddled me and told me I was safe. He took us out to pizza, and the three of us shared a plate as we tried to process what had just happened. Most women and some men have a different response to stress and danger. We've been told all of our lives that faced with threat, we go into fight or flight mode. But actually, that's not true. Instead of trying to run away from a problem or fight it, some people might instead focus on taking care of themselves and those around them. They'll try to befriend others and find allies to rally against what is causing the stress or danger. Precode talks about tend and befriend in her many talks and links it to the games we see around us. She asks, why are they mostly about fighting or running from danger? What about games which are about rallying up friends or strengthening bonds between people, taking care of those you love? Taking time for yourself, confiding a secret with a friend. There's so many more things games could be. Bricot's talk was eye-opening to me. I never understood people that told me that when they're feeling tense, they like to play a round of doom to distress. There's nothing calming about shooting monsters in the face and seeing blood splash everywhere. What I do when I'm stressed is open up Stardew Valley. I water my plants and pet my animals. Or play Skyrim, which I have modded to remove any fighting, and added a survival sim instead. So I spend my days making pelts to keep warm in such an icy world, and pack vegetables to turn into broths on my camping trip up a scenic mountain. I unapologetically turn the mode of any game to easy because all I care about is talking to the characters and bonding with them over a campfire. Bioshock games are one of my favorite games to turn on easy mode. I'll quickly get the killing over with in a minute so I can spend an hour or two just exploring every corner of the level for traces of the narrative and piece together what happened to these characters. After Bricot's talk, I finally understood why what I wanted out of my games was so different. I wanted to make the April 10th game about the support and love I felt from the friends that were there for me. The yoga we did together, the hugs, the pizza we shared. To me, that day was all about feeling tended to by people who cared about me. When I was feeling alone and scared, they jumped in and told me they were there. And that was it. That was the theme I'd be making my game around. The language we use to describe our inner worlds is often physical. When we talk about our emotions, we talk about them like they are happening around us. For example, say you leave school and are left out to fend for yourself in the wide world, and you don't know what to do next. You're not sure if you want to get a job in the degree that you did. Maybe you didn't like it as much as you hoped. But now you have no idea what is right for your future. You would say you feel lost. As in, you're in the middle of a field of fog. You don't know where you are or what direction to take. Or maybe you're living with your boyfriend in a bad relationship and want to get out. But rent everywhere is too high, so you can't afford not to share a room with this man. And your options start feeling a little bit limited. You'd say you feel trapped, as in you're caught in a cage with no way out. The physical is what grounds us. It's the common experience we all share, and so we use it to reference what is happening inside of us. These little metaphors can be used as wonderful sources of inspiration for mechanics for games. Listen to them next time you're describing to someone how you're feeling. I'll often project my own emotions to game mechanics. Maybe that feeling of talking to and trying to build a relationship with a difficult family member is like climbing a mountain with terrible controls. Overworking and not paying attention to yourself might be like a Jenga game. Each bit of work you do without giving yourself a break is like removing another block from your foundations. And the weight of it comes back to add pressure on you from above, until eventually you collapse. Florence, the mobile game, does a wonderful job at describing that feeling when you're getting to know someone and at first conversation feels hard, but then as you get to know each other better, it just starts to flow. At first you're puzzling together a sentence out of many pieces, but after a while, there's only one puzzle piece, and it flows out smoothly. These experiences have given me no doubt that game mechanics can express something so much bigger than themselves. What was difficult wasn't what happened on April 10th. It was the repercussions that came after. I developed PTSD. And I remember cowering any time I heard a noise, thinking it was him. Sometimes I'd break a sweat, simply because I had tripped against something triggering on Twitter. Or I'd go to the shops and feel sick at the sight of a beetroot. He loved beetroot and would eat them every day. And I've never hated beetroots, but I haven't been able to eat those things ever since. And I still can't bear to hear a man raising his voice. I really don't trust men who get angry. I started going to therapy to try and work through it. She labeled what I was going through and helped me navigate the trauma. One thing she mentioned struck out to me and would become the foundations for my April 10th game. She told me, everyone has a plant that grows inside of us. Every once in a while, we need to pay attention to it and make sure it's okay. In the same way we check in on our houseplants and water them every once in a while. Since April 10th, I started taking care of plants. I get them secondhand from strangers who would tell me their origin stories, how they had cut a snipping from the mother plant and flew it across the ocean from Cuba, or how that spurt came from her great-grandfather's garden from the 1800s. These backstories make each plant feel like a person to me. Every morning I wake up and check in on them to make sure they're okay. Then I check in on myself and make sure I'm okay. The act of taking care of a plant becomes the same thing as taking care of yourself. Let's take a moment to talk about experiential gestalts. It might sound like a scary word, but experiential gestalts is just a fancy way of saying experiences that share the same patterns. Taking care of a plant and taking care of yourself shares the same experiential gestalt. They're both about assessing a living creature and providing for its needs. Let me set an easier example. You walk into a room and there's Lego everywhere. You need to get to the other side, and so you tiptoe around the Lego to not step on it. That is the same experiential gestalt as walking your dog in the dog park and trying not to step on poo, which is the same experiential gestalt as playing Minesweeper and trying not to click on the mines. All three of them might seem like very different experiences, but actually they share the same mechanics, which is trying to avoid bad things in a given area. You can take an experiential gestalt and break it down into its component parts and use those parts as your game atoms. Game atoms are the smallest components of your game mechanics. If you took a game system and kept chopping it down until you couldn't break it apart, that final game mechanic is a game atom. Raf Koster talks about them in his book, A Theory of Fun. Games are made up of game atoms. For example, in the Pokemon games, one atom might be collecting. You have to go out there and collect all the different variety of Pokemon that there are in the world. I mean, the tagline of Pokemon is literally, gotta catch 'em all. But there are other atoms which make up a Pokemon game, like fighting or trading. These atoms all connect to each other and make up a network of mechanics. This network is the game system. So when you're designing a game, you're adding or removing game atoms which affect each other and shape the system in different ways. When looking at a human experience, you can also break it down into its atoms and map out how that experience works. What are the patterns in how you're feeling? Who are the actors and what are they doing? What are your different emotional states? What influences them? The resulting system often looks a lot like a game system. Designing then becomes an act of matching experiences to game mechanics via their experiential gestalts. I keep seeing my own experience everywhere after April 10th. Everything that was happening in the news felt so raw and familiar. Angry men are everywhere. They're entitled and demand authority and harm other people and get away with it. They suffer no consequences and the cycle just repeats itself. I saw videos of Brett Kavanaugh in the hearings where he was accused for sexual assault by Christine Blasey Ford. Ford talked calmly, respectfully. Meanwhile, Kavanaugh burst into violent spats of anger, his face contorted in that ugly, angry way that reminded me of my aggressor. When the verdict came out not guilty, it was my turn to get angry. He was another woman, eloquent and polite, who had her boundaries transgressed, and no one listened to her. This man showed his hateful, toxic, appalling, detestable, and violent side on the pulpit itself, and still, no one listened. Nothing got done. I'm scared. I'm scared that this is just going to repeat itself. Over and over again, women will come out. They'll scream, "Me too," and nothing will change. We'll get kicked out of jobs, opportunities, communities, galleries, shows. We'll feel entirely isolated and alone and unsupported and scared while men shout at us. "How dare we demonize them," they say, as they violate our boundaries and make us feel small and powerless and insignificant. A friend will come in and hug me. He'll tell me I'm safe. He's on my side. I feel better. Game mechanics, even simple ones, can express something bigger than themselves. For me, it was that touch from a friend that told me I was not alone. That meant so much. When I was going through another episode of PTSD, a friend would reach in and hug me out of it. Such a simple act took me from being alone and scared to feeling supported and cared for. It's the same experiential gestalt as someone placing a reassuring hand on your shoulder, or kissing a wound to make it better, or watching your plant when it's thirsty, or receiving a message from your friend asking if you're okay, or a simple tap on your phone screen. I think a computer might as well think it's entirely alone until you click on it, letting it know you're there. All of these experiences and thoughts gave shape to my meditations game, April 10th. By this point, I had spent a month thinking about it and doodling my thoughts in my notebook. When I sat down in front of Unity, the game came out fully formed. I made it in a little more than a day. In the game, you're taking care of a plant. It grows very slowly over the course of the day. There's a soft heartbeat in the background, and you can tap the grass for some satisfying plinky-plonky sounds. You can leave the plant to grow as you go about your day. But every once in a while, the plant can get scared. Everything turns darker, and the heartbeat starts racing. Tap on the plant to let it know you're there. It's okay. The plant will go back to normal, its heartbeat will slow again, and it will continue to grow happily. Remember to check in on it every once in a while to make sure it's okay. The game became a reminder to listen to myself and take care. It's the game I wish I had throughout all that turmoil. It is also a celebration of those friends who turned to check up on me when I couldn't take care of myself. Finishing the game felt like such a relief. Like I had just climbed a mountain and was finally at the summit. It's been over a year now since April 10th, 2018, and I think I can finally say I am actually okay. I'm not great, but I am better, and making this game was a big step towards that. On April 10th this year, the game came out. I was in Berlin for the start of a maze festival, surrounded by friends. I had just come back from Thailand for Pirate Jam, where I had the time of my life. And although I could always do with more freelance work in order to get by, I felt I had supportive and caring people around me. And that's more than I could imagine and have, or even deserve, a year ago. The game was playable only on April 10th this year, and will be playable again on April 10th next year, and the year after that. Now when I think about that day, I don't think about the trauma. I think about that plant, growing inside of me, and inside each and every one of us. And I want to say, thank you for taking care of it.